G'day YouTube. This is Big Ideas. It's a forum on youth justice in Queensland on ABC Radio National. I got the camera on night mode and I'm having an outside fire.
Incidents of significant conduct disorder. Teacher intervention programs, early parenting programs also have been found to reduce the incidence of conduct disorder. It's not going to take it away, but it reduces the incidence. Now, these programs are costly, but they cost a lot less than $600 a day if you run this in an individual detention centre. But the other issue, the main issue here, is that these programs take 10 or more years to show any fruit. I've mentioned some nurse-instigated family planning and support programs. These have been rolled out in the States for targeted mothers who are at risk to abuse their children, neglect their children, and have poor parenting skills. Targeted nurse education programs reduce the risk of conduct disorder, no question. But you're looking at those targeting children that are 1 year of age. So by the time they're 12 or 14 or 16, we're looking at four, five, six election cycles. I mean, that's ancient history. Yeah? It's much easier to try to put in a program. We understand that the government is influenced by public perception, and in a three-year term, they don't have much time to put in place something that's going to act. So it's much easier to put in something short and sharp, no matter how costly, rather than investing in the future of our young people. What about in the more immediate term? Are there, for example, enough substance abuse rehabilitation facilities? Are there enough facilities for dealing with the immediate problems that those kids face?
No, there's a dearth of facilities. I mean, we're always crying out that we need more funding. But in Queensland, if you live outside Metro Brisbane, there is no adolescent drug and alcohol counselling program. None. And in terms of mental health programs, there is essentially no developed adolescent forensic counselling programs outside of Brisbane and to a small extent Townsville. And certainly there's no funding for an expansion of programs. That is an area that we need to
cut.
Because there's no point, and I'm talking from a mental health viewpoint, there's no point managing these young people in a youth detention centre, improving their mental health, and then sending them out to the community, to the same toxic peer group, to the same dysfunctional family, to the same substance-using environment. Brian Freddie knows what's going to happen to their mental health. Okay, it's going to deteriorate. And the question is not just what we can offer immediately in the youth detention centre, but it's what we can offer these kids after they're released from detention. But that's only the tip of the iceberg. There's a whole vast array of young people out there who are within the youth justice system who haven't entered the detention centre, who are at high risk of engaging in sexual offences, violent offences. We have mental health programs that can identify those young people. There are very few funded programs to treat them.
I can see Janet's been nodding through a lot of that. And the other issue, Janet, is kids being excluded from school, perhaps because they have some of the issues actually that Stephen's been speaking about. You know, you take a kid out of school and you throw them onto the street with a whole bunch of other kids who've been excluded from school, and you know, you don't need to be a genius to figure out what will happen there. That's a challenging problem too.
It is, and I mean, obviously all that happens if you suspend or exclude a young person from school is you just move the problem. You haven't solved anything, you've just moved the problem and given it to somebody else. And I mean, it is a concern, I think, that young people who have challenging behaviours...
It's the art of politics, isn't it? Move the problem and give it to somebody else.
You find have mild to moderate Asperger's, autism spectrum disorder issues, perhaps even just literacy and numeracy issues, and so they play up because they don't want to... it's the only way they can manage in class, you know, is to avoid real actually having to do the work because they can't. It's interesting the proportion of young people in detention, for example, who you then find are well overrepresented in those sorts of diagnoses, together with hearing and sight problems, which again has an impact on schooling. And that's exactly right. There are really clear correlations between being excluded from the education system and being at high risk of involvement. delinquent in the youth justice system.
What do the schools need to do about it? Because part of the problem with these misbehaving kids is that they can make the educational environment extremely disruptive for those who are there to learn. So it's a difficult situation for the principals and teachers as well, I would have thought.
But the thing is, I think with all of this, we have to stop looking at everything in silos and isolation. So this is a whole problem that needs to be dealt with along a spectrum of different areas. So clearly teachers are not there to manage these sorts of behaviours. They're there to teach. But if you've got a young person who's exhibiting these sorts of issues, then you would like to think there were appropriate health-related facilities that the school could refer to, if not close to the school, within the school, who could then look at that, do some counselling, make appropriate referrals, assuming you've got the services that you can refer them to. But I think we need to be quite clear that for a lot of the young people we're talking about, we're talking them in the legal system as a way of a legal response to what is actually social, welfare, relationship, mental health, etc. issues. So it's not it's not really about the law. It's really about a range of things that underpin their behaviour. And unless we address that, just relying on the law to deal with it by punishing them, putting them into detention, whatever, we're really not getting to the cause of the issue.
Yeah, can I also say that many of the issues that we've spoken about tonight so far are exacerbated, of course, in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities and people from that background. We don't really have anyone on the panel here tonight who works specifically with that group of people, which is why, you know, much of the questioning has not been about that, but it's an extremely important issue and quite possibly one that we can take up specifically next year. But I encourage the panel, if you have worked with people from that background, to bring those examples up. But just on that issue of exclusion from school, Jan, would you find that a number of your clients fit into that category, that they're not at school when they teach for us?
I would say that's the single worst determinative factor for our client base. Really, the dysfunction in a family can happen in good families, and I'm not disrespecting some of the doctor's greater knowledge, but if a child is unsupervised for those hours, they're going to get in trouble. It's not rocket science. So it is the single common denominator for me, that they're not engaged, or they're not engaged in some sort of school or work or something like that.
Well, just to add to that, if you look at cognitive functioning and you look at the normal community, about 3-5% of people in any normal cohort will have an IQ of about 75% or less, and what we call in the borderline range. There's been multiple studies looking at young people in youth detention, and the percentage of young people in youth detention who have a functioning at a borderline or below rate is anywhere, depending on the study, between 25% and 45%. So you're looking at a cohort of young people who are skewed right to the left, and so that has significant flow-on effects in terms of, well, not just in terms of their education, but also in terms of their understanding of the law. Stephen, you practice as an adolescent forensic psychiatrist. What can you tell us about the adolescent brain? Last night, Big Ideas broadcast was talked by Professor Lawrence Steinberg on adolescent risk-taking. We've already had...
Here endeth part two.